We will have an opportunity of listening to one of our own community who will share with us their own testimony, their own experience of meeting God. The person we have today is a very young woman. Everybody is young these days. Her name is Angie Nussbaumer, and she comes from the Cathedral Parish of St. Finan's in Alexandria. She's a young mother, 4.5 children. She meets the Canadian statistic, which is 2.3. And she is going to share with us today how she encountered God, how God came into her life, and what that difference made to her life.
Thank you, Father. One of the things that I did not tell Father Kevin, and maybe I should have, would have been suitable for the introduction, but is that next month, April 10th, I have a really big anniversary coming. So it'll be my 10th year anniversary of being received into the Catholic Church. And often as with a lot of converts, there's usually an interesting story behind it. And so that is what I'm going to share with you today. My conversion started when I was a teenager, when I started to go to church with my grandma. My grandma's Protestant, so it was a Protestant church that I was going to, which is like most of the churches in Smith Falls, the town that I was raised in. Now, a couple years later, it was time for me to go to college, and that is where I met my husband, Tony. And in time, things started to become more serious, and we had made an agreement that when we got married, he was going to keep his Catholic church, the Catholic faith, and I was going to shop around the town of Alexandria, because he's a dairy farmer, so it was clear we were going to live in Alexandria, until I found the best preacher. Well, the Lord often has different plans for us. And after a couple of weeks of particularly poor preaching at our church, at the Protestant church I was going to, I decided to check out the Catholic church in Smith Falls, St. Francis de Sales. So I was at the Mass, and was near the end of the Mass, and the priest was one of those priests that did a really good job of giving a real prayerful service. And so it was the end of Mass, and it was a great moment of silence. And I'm sitting there, and the Holy Spirit came down on me, and I remember feeling the most profound sense of peace. And I just wish I could take, you know, if there was a button on time, you just press pause, and just never let time go on. Never move from that pew and sit there for the rest of eternity. Well, we still live in a world of time. Reality exists. And the moment of silence was broken with an announcement by the priest. And his announcement was that in a couple weeks, our CIA would be starting. Needless to say, I signed up. Now, there's a few things I want to explain about this little church of St. Francis de Sales, because I realize you may not be familiar with the Smith Falls area, is that this is a much smaller congregation than, for instance, St. Peter's here is. Smith Falls is not like Cornwall, where, you know, the majority of the churches are Catholic. This is a Protestant town. So this one little Catholic church had 5 to 6 converts a year at a time. It's pretty phenomenal for a small parish. And the other thing that was quite remarkable at this parish, and I did not realize that at the time, but I certainly do now, is that they had 24-hour Eucharistic adoration at this parish. That's a huge sacrifice for a small congregation. Well, I started to attend the adoration, especially before work. And I soon wanted my own hour of adoration. But there was an interesting problem. There was no available hours at the adoration chapel. I was out of luck. Well, at the time, I would visit Tony every Wednesday. And one Wednesday night, once he was done barn chores, we headed out to Cornwall, and he told me we were going to go to St. Columban's, so that's where the adoration. Appalachian Chapels because he knew how much I love Eucharistic adoration. And as we're driving down the 138, I'm starting to get suspicious because anyone who knows my husband knows that he's one of the most cool, calm, and collected guys. He's not a guy to get nervous very often. But boy, is he nervous. And I've never seen him like that since. So I got pretty suspicious at this moment. So I turned him and looked at him. He said, "Tony, do you have a ring in your pocket?" He pulled over in front of the gas station that's just at the end of 138. Probably most of you guys know of that gas station. And he pulled out the ring. And of course, obviously, as you know, I have 4 children now. The fifth on the way, what my answer was. From there, we continued to head to St. Columbus. And boy, was I disappointed when I got there. I realized that was the place that the proposal was supposed to happen. Beautiful St. Columbus. Instead, I got the gas station and the 138. Teaches me a little bit about patience, I think. I was headed to St. Julian's Chapel, and as I often did at the time, I'd always pick up a few pamphlets before heading into the chapel. And I sat down, looked at the pamphlets I'd taken, and they were for the sick and the dying. Not only anyone that was sick or dying, I put them back, and besides, I just became engaged, right? You have other things that you really want to pray about. Well, there was a lady who was there praying, and she asked us, "Could you please take over this hour? The person who was supposed to come to the hour did not show up." And Tony and I were good with that. Well, about half an hour later, the next person showed up. And she, as she walked in, and just made an announcement. She said, "We don't know what we are going to do. Lucy, who has this hour before me, has passed away. Who is going to take over her hour?" Needless to say, I went and got those pamphlets, the sick and the dying, picked out an appropriate prayer for her, and we signed up for her hour. And what a soothing way to start an engagement by taking on weekly adoration. And as a newly engaged woman, after I had prayed for her soul, I asked a favor of her. I asked her if she would pray for our marriage. And certainly what I didn't realize at that time was how much we needed that hour of adoration. For the following year was turned out to be a pretty tough year for us. And now I realize that Satan did not want us to get married. For it seemed I really had wanted to break up with Tony. Would have been the biggest mistake of my life. But the Holy Spirit kept convincing us time and again that this was the right thing. And for Tony, it was the feeling he had after Eucharistic adoration that convinced him that this was something worth fighting for. And he did. Now, I didn't give Lucy much thought until about a year later. Our wedding date was approaching, and we were on a skiing trip with a group of people. And upon returning from Tromblon to Cornwall, it became clear to me that we were running late. And being Wednesday night, the night of my hour of adoration, I asked the driver if they could please drop me off at the St. Julian's Adoration Chapel. And from the back of the van, one of the people who had joined us on the skiing trip, he was a widower in the past year. He announced, he goes, "That used to be my wife Lucy's hour." Whoa. Yeah. The Lucy I had asked prayers from the night of our engagement. And I just had to know. I asked him, "Did you have a good marriage?" And with tears in his eyes, he announced that yes, it was a very good marriage. And so it is at this time that I want to end big thank you to you Lucy's out there. You know who you are. Every week, you loyally show up to your hour of Eucharistic adoration. I thank you, for you have changed my life.
Angie, thank you. Thank you for sharing those personal moments of your life, how you encountered Christ, and how he changed it. Thank you also for sharing Lucy with all of us.